I am under no illusion that you have come to listen to me. Just like you, I am also eager to listen to Govindacharya ji. As a student, way back in 80s, I heard Govindan ji when he was South Zone Organizing Secretary of the Akhil Bharati Vidyarthi Parishad. Then as a Pracharak, in the 90s, mid-90s, I have heard him speak during Janadesh Yatra in Dibrugarh, Assam. This is another pious occasion for me to listen to him once again. He has been one of our guiding forces ideologically. So I know that I should not stand between you and Govindanji for long. I have just 2 points to make, after which I would give way. This confusion over nationhood basically is a result of our juxtaposing essentially Western concepts of nation and nation state against the Indian concept of civilizational state. Most of the researchers that have been done in the realm of political science across the world are on the Western concepts, nation, nation state. But India is a civilizational state. Unless we understand this, I think we cannot explain the nationhood that India is. And this is where most of those who are criticizing on the issue of nationalism are actually making a mistake. The nation state is a Western concept. Back to, a nation has arisen, it arose in the 16th century from the Westphalia Agreement. After that, nation states have come into being in the 17th and 18th centuries. Lot of countries in the Gulf, in the West Asia, they have been created by the imperialist forces. For instance, Syria and Iraq, which are now facing a lot of turmoil, two administrators by name Sykes and Picot, they sat together somewhere in Europe and they then drew a line, as they called, from E in the Acre to the K in the Kirkuk. And they divided Syria and Iraq into two parts. It's the same people who have been separated by an artificially created boundary. Same kind of situation we see in the Pakhtunistan of Pakistan. The Pakhtuns of Pakistan are more at home with the Pakhtuns of the southern Kabul, southern Afghanistan, than with the Punjabis of Pakistan. We have Baluchis separated by a boundary line between Iran and Pakistan. The Baluchis of Pakistan feel greater affinity with the Baluchs of Sistan Baluchistan province of Iran. So this is essentially because the West has failed to understand the difference between a civilizational state and a nation state which is artificially created. I think unless we understand this concept of civilizational state that India is, we will continue to make mistakes in understanding India. In India, we've been seeing a process of nationalization of the populations. For instance, there are over 3,000 villages which are named after Ram. One of them is in East Godavari district. It is known as Sakhinetipalli. The story goes that Rama and Sita, during their vanvas, they go to an area and Sita is totally tired and she asks Rama, Prabhu, Neti Palle Edi. Prabhu, where do we rest today? Then Rama, it seems, has told her that Sakhi Neti Palle Ide, let us rest here today. So the name of the village is Sakhi Neti Palle. A rationalist would ask, how Rama from Ayodhya and Sita from Janakpur, Nepal, speak Telugu? But for people who are steeped in this concept of nationalism, people who have become part and parcel of this culture, this becomes very normal for them. Sakhinetipalli is a village where Lord Ram may never have visited, but it is trying to co-opt itself into the Ramayana legend. There is a village called Sita, Siddhantam in East Godavari. It's actually the boundary between East and West Godavari districts. This story goes that that is the place where Sita has disappeared into Mother Earth. So it is Siddhantam which has become Siddhantam. Linguistically, Siddhantam can never become, Siddhantam can never become Siddhantam. But wants to identify itself with Lord Rama, the legend of Rama. So naturally, it is trying to invent a way where it can co-opt itself into this national mainstream. I have visited the coastal area starting from Konapapapeta in Tuni down to Vemula Devi in West Godavari district. All across the West Godavari eastern coast, I have seen from Konapapapeta to Vemula Devi, there are over 40 Ramalingeshwara Swami temples. Each temple says the same story. Lord Rama offered prayers to Lord Shiva before slaying Ravana. He could have done it at only one place, that could be Rameshwaram. But there are 40 villages in two districts of East Godavari and West Godavari which say that Lord Rama has come here and offered prayer to Lord Shiva to slay Ravana. This is nothing but formation of a nationalism. Over a period of time, this has been happening in this country. We have a lot of villages which identify themselves with historical and legendary figures. This is nationalism. I have worked in Assam for about 12 years. In Assam, just as we have had invaders from the west, Assam had invaders from the east. We had invaders in the 7th century from the western frontiers, Bakhtiyar Khilji, Muhammad ibn Qasim, so on and so forth. But the intensity of the invasions was in 12th century. At the same time, there were invasions from the eastern frontier also. From Burma, kings have come, the invaders have come into Assam. And they started ruling Assam much in the same way the Mughals and Khiljis and Pathans and all these people have ruled Delhi and rest of the Aryavarta. They started with names like Sukafa, Sudamfa, Suhungmung, Sudamfa, and gradually over a period of 200 years or 300 years, the names have changed into Jayadhvaja Simha, Chakradhvaja Simha, Rudra Simha, Pratapa Simha, so on and so forth. Even today, the Ahoms of Assam, who have migrated from southern Burma into Assam, they have a different language of their own. They have their own pujaris known as Bailungs. They have their own pujas known as Sakalang. But they find themselves one with the rest of the country. This kind of harmonious blending of the societies into one nation has happened in the eastern border. For some reason, this has not happened in the western border, but even in the western border, even in the western frontier and even in the mainland of India, we have seen a process of nationalism sprouting, a synthesis of nationalism sprouting. For instance, Shah Jahangir used to celebrate Holi, and he used to call Holi Eid Gulabi. We have had our own Rahim Khan Khanas, who said, Dhul dharat nija shisha par kah Rahim kehi kaj jo raja munipatni tari so dhundat gajarad. So nationalism is a process over a period of time through various streams coming together and forming into one whole mainstream. This has to be understood. In the 15th century, Assam Srimanta Shankaradeva chants, Dhanya Dhanya Kalikal, Dhanya Naratanubhal, Dhanya Dhanya Bharatavarish. He has not said Dhanya Dhanya Assamvarish. He has said Dhanya Dhanya Bharatavarish. Same way, Nepal, Bhanu Bhakta writes the first translated Ramayana version in Nepali and talks about Bharatvarsha. Process of nationalism, nationalization of the society that is going on. A person from the rural interiors of Karimnagar, when he goes to Dharmapuri to have a dip in Godavari, he says, Nen Gangaga Botuna. He never says that I am going to Godavari. For him, that is Ganga. So this process of integration, which has been taking place over hundreds and thousands of years, is sought to be reversed by this very you know, devious debate that is going on about nationalism today. He will throw more light on these issues. I do not really have to elaborate on this point. I know that what we need to appreciate and understand is that this process of nationalism, process of nationalization of this people is irreversible. People who have come from Shan region of Burma, people who have come from other regions of Burma, they have become part and parcel of this nation. They say they are from Greece. The Shakaldivipi Brahmins of Kashi region, they say they are from Egypt. So this, Rabindranath Tagore has spoken about this, people from different streams, they come here, they join here, they come here, they become one. Even Maulana Ali, a famous Sufi saint, has said that wah deen hijaz ka bebak beda kiya jisne sato samandar par, deen hijaz ka bebak beda is Islam, kiya jisne sato samandar par, jo kabul mein atka na jabul mein atka ja aake duba darya ganga mein aakar. That is the reason why when you go to Kadapa Darga, you would find that the Sufis there, the Qadris there, the Qadri sect, the Qadriya sect of the Sufis there, they wear saffron caps. That is the reason why you find that the Sufis in Ajmer Darga wear saffron caps. There is a process of Indianization going on. It would have happened, it would have gathered pace had not Britishers come and interrupted this process. Otherwise, Shia region, the Shia legendary figures, Hassan and Hussein. You have a lot of Ashannas and Hushannas. Our opposition leader is Jana Reddy, who is named after Janpad Darga in Nalgonda. So the process of integration that was going on was interrupted in 1857, and that process needs to be reinvented. The way we have amalgamated various tribes from Northeast, various tribes from across the country, various groups of people who have come to India and have become part of it, the same way the rest of the country and those who are now trying to rake up a debate also need to be integrated. I sincerely hope Govindanji will actually dwell upon these issues and enlighten all of us. Dhanyavad for giving me this opportunity.